No, I don't think so.
So, any of the latest slides do you have?
Solutions. So this is the SAG session. We're going to get going in a couple of minutes, or a couple of seconds maybe. Okay, good afternoon. Let's take our seats. So this is the Security Area Advisory Group. We have the usual kind of agenda. You should note well, the note well. Thanks to DKG for taking notes. And I can't remember which of you won the battle. Yaron is the Jabber Scribe. This is our agenda. Anybody want to bash the agenda? Nope. Okay, next one. So we have the usual thing where we go through the list of working groups, and a lot of people have already sent mail to the SAG list with a brief synopsis of their status. So if you've done that, you don't need to jump to the mic, but if you haven't, please just jump to the mic and give us that. So next one. AbFab didn't meet, almost done. Next. ACE. So just yell out if you did already send a mail. So do we have somebody who can tell us what happened in ACE if they didn't already send a mail to the list? They're being shy. Okay, nothing happened at ACE. Okay, next. ACME, thank you. Next. COSE, thank you. Next. Curdle. Mail sent, great. Dane didn't meet.
Trying to shut down.
Oliver wants to close his working group again. Dots. Thank you. HTTP auth. Thank you. I2NSF sent mail, I think, as well, yeah. IPSecMe sent mail, yeah, good. Jose, done, thank you. Keep going. Kitten. He sent his predictive message mile. Was it a mail sent? Yeah, good. OAuth. Was there a mail sent about OAuth? No. And so ACE and OAuth are being shy, and they have a common character there. Okay. So if Hannes walks in, you should grab him and tell him that. OpenPGP, tell us briefly what happened. If you didn't send a mail, then just pop up to the mic and give us a quick state of play, just in two sentences. This is punishment.
we have a 4880 bis draft up. that's not adopted yet by the working group. There's ongoing work on streamable authenticated encryption and merging of existing work.
Thank you. Sagam. Thanks. Next. TLS. Joe gets punished.
Well, in TLS, we discussed a bunch of 1.3 issues that we've come to mostly resolution on. They'll be confirmed on the list. The one thing that folks in this group might want to note is one of the features in TLS 1.3 is a zero RTT mode that, if used incorrectly, can allow data to be replayed, and which could be potentially dangerous for some applications that use it. So we've been contacting various people who know about various protocols to see if this is going to, if this is something that would cause a problem in their protocol. I mean, it's an optional feature, but we want to make sure that if it happens to be turned on, we'd like to know where the problem spots would be. So if you have an idea of a protocol that might be of interest to us, contact either Sean or I.
Great. So yes, I think if anybody's running a protocol that runs over TLS and is likely to upgrade to TLS 1.3, which you probably would, then figuring this out now would be like a really good thing. And there's a fine example, I think, that DKG did for the Deprive working group and kind of analyzing the impact. And something like that, I think, would be useful for lots of protocols. Hannes, do you want to tell us what happened at OAuth and ACE? Here, up the front. You're late and you didn't send a mail.
Yeah, I thought it would help if I show up later so you forget, but apparently didn't. In ACE, we met on Monday morning and spent most of the time talking about the open issues with the selected protocol on OAuth version. And we also talked about a new encoding of the JSON web token, namely in the using SIBO instead, which is a more a compressed format for use with some of the wireless links that you find with low power radios. In OAuth, we had a lot of discussions about the newly charted items. We talked about discovery specification, which we even had a site meeting afterwards because of some dispute. We spoke about the native applications and other extensions. So we are, as the meeting didn't quite go in the way I thought it would be. So we are sort of brainstorming on whether we should be doing a sort of a ref of OAuth 2.1 version, which a mailer sent to the list soliciting input to fold in some of the security work that we had been doing instead of having it in separate documents. But it remains to be seen what the outcome of that discussion is.
Okay, thanks.
Where were we at? Tokenbind.
Tokenbind, did they send a mail? Yes, thank you. Plans? Sent mail? Great. So actually, I have a question about that. I should back up first. Sorry. You know, as you know, Kathleen is not here because she's at home with a new baby and having fun. So I think she's on Jabber and audio maybe. And I just wanted to thank Yoa for helping out with presenting, because there's lots of laptop screens up here and it's very useful. So thanks. And on the reports, Robert sent a mail saying you can now enter those in the data tracker. So I just want to ask people, how many people sent an email about their working group with a status to SAG? Okay, and how many of you entered it into Tracker also? Okay, so just a couple. I think it'd be worth a try and we'll see if it's kind of useful. Robert?
Yeah, so if anybody wants to upload it and runs into any difficulties, I'm in the back of the room today. Just sneak back and we can get it done that fast.
And there's no way that to get a single view of the security area reports on one page, is there?
Not right now, okay. But it's easy to build.
Okay, thanks. You might ask for that later. Okay, so other related kind of non-security area working groups and research groups and associated entities. This is the list that we had almost for last time. So if anybody wants to tell us what's happening at one of these, now's a good time to jump up to the mic and tell us if there's something that the security area ought to know or care about.
Oh, Paul Hoffman, Dbound is probably not going to form a working group. We have three or four very interested authors and not much else, but there's still a discussion going on that might get revived. The reason why it's important here is this would be the thing that comes after the public suffix list to replace it. And the last discussion, which I'll take credit for, I'm not sure it's actually going to go anywhere, is to maybe do public suffix list plus plus, meaning give the public suffix list a way of getting better information or not. But it's really, there's a really good chance it's just going to die without any action.
Okay. And Sandy, I apologize for still misspelling cider about 4 years later. So slide copy where.
Well, that was actually going to be my main comment. The CIDR working group met twice, and the second meeting on Wednesday had some presentations about kind of deployment issues and asking for working group adoption. Not sure what's going to go on for most of those. There was one very interesting one that D6 is going to be is going to use the same model that AMSIX used to use their route server to propagate origin validation signaling for their members, and so that's an interesting deployment aspect. But part of the Wednesday's meeting was a discussion of we're down to deployment issues, not routing issues. Does CIDR really belong in routing anymore? What are we going to do with that? And all that sort of stuff. Security area was mentioned as one possible home. So I bring that up. And the other discussion point was whether or not the security protocol should be experimental or standard. So,
okay. And I have fixed the spelling of the working group name in my copy, at least.
Okay. Thank you.
Karen, are you at the mic, or are you? I think you were first, but.
I just wanted to mention, I mentioned this last time, the Network Time Protocol NTP working group. And the network time security, there's three drafts related to network time security. Last time I told you that they were going into working group last call and to pay attention to them, they did go through working group last call. We've had extensive comments, so we would still appreciate some help. We are going to set up a design team to deal with the issues that were raised during working group last call, and there will be a second working group last call.
Thank you. Bob?
802.15.9 has gone fully through approvals. It's now to the IEEE editor for final document formatting and cleanup. Don't know yet when it'll be published, probably in the June-July timeframe. 802.15.9 is a mechanism for transporting key management protocols on an 802.15.4 Mac. So it's a way that we can do the key management for any 802.15.4 network.
Okay. Thank you.
So Kyle Rose, so TCP Inc. actually meets this evening. If you guys are interested in this but have been frustrated by the lack of progress, we're actually making progress now and moving TCP Crypt and TCP Eno, which are two drafts, on a path to standardization. So one thing we're looking for is an independent implementation based on the spec. So if you're interested, maybe show up tonight.
Thanks, and thanks for picking something.
Okay, I would like to speak for Utah. Utah met on Monday this week, and the focus of our work shifted to email protocols. We have three drafts. We got one new draft among these three drafts. One is the new draft, which talks about how to use TLS with between MTAs, which was discussed in details, and there was a lot of interest to proceed with this work. Yet not as a working group draft, but it needs to be revised first. We have an ongoing work which addresses the interface between MUA and MTA, and the two drafts probably needs to be synchronized in some way. And we have a third draft, which basically the idea is to allow the endpoints to request to use a TLS through the whole routing path of the email, hop by hop, obviously. So this is what we are doing, and and you know, you are welcome to join us.
Thank you.
Sarah Dickinson, a short update on DPrive. So very recently, last week, I believe, the DNS over TLS draft was approved as an RFC, which is great news, yay. The work on DNS over DTLS is still continuing, and that draft is moving along. We also spent a lot of time this week when we met talking about the authentication profiles that we should use for DNS over TLS or DTLS. And we're trying to produce a combined document and propose mechanisms for how to do domain name based authentication. And one of the things we're looking at there is using a new TLS extension that will allow the client to get the full validation chain during the TLS handshake, which is a really nice mechanism, but there's some overlap there. So between DNS now and the TLS working group, so we'd appreciate TLS folks taking a look at that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Any others? No, great, thank you. Boff, so you had one Boff this time, is Lurk. I see Yaron is there. Do you want to just tell us how that went a bit? Or Eric, if he's here.
Yeah, so we did send mail, but anyway, there was a lot of participation, a lot of interest, quite a bit of unclarity about where we're headed. So the sense of the room was that we will continue to have a lively discussion on the mailing list, and we'll probably need to meet again in Berlin.
Okay, thank you. And presentations. Okay, so I think Rich is next. Rich, do you want to jump in the pink box?
Rich Sauls, at least this way people would turn around. When it's up front, it's okay. So I put out Stephen asked me to help to start a kick off a draft up for what could hopefully be a BCP. The goal is really to keep bad crypto out of IETF standards. Some people have asked, is there any other agenda? And are we trying to, do only one kind of crypto, only one kind of boring thing, and the answer to that is no. That seems to have come through, that other impression seems to have come through, that's a fault of my writing, so we'll fix that. But the basic problem is the IETF is not competent or timely enough to review all crypto mechanisms. We're also not the crypto forum, or we're not the crypto conference, real world crypto, Usenix security and things like that. So the solution to this problem seems to be, or a proposed solution, is that we come up with rough consensus on how we can address the goal. And the goal is that we may not require all of the review. We certainly still want to require specifications to be implemented. But we go out and we make sure that anything that is mandatory has enough public review that we can feel comfortable in accepting it. Now, pardon me. That's pretty straightforward. Shouldn't be too controversial. It seems to have kicked up a bit, but that's probably because I didn't do as good a job authoring as needed. Did you have a question, Martin? Okay. So logistics. That's the name of the draft. It was notes to myself as to what to include in. Suggest just take that as the title. It could change. The current home is on GitHub. The current discussion is here on the SAG mailing list. Where it goes after, at some point, then we'll move it to another, out of an individual draft if necessary or if desired. Next. Some concrete examples about what does it mean to be good enough. I know when I see it, that's not good enough, unless maybe you're Dan Bernstein, right? Maybe I'm kidding on that. nobody cracked this, and nobody claimed my reward of $200. That's also not good enough. There's various reasons why crypto contests as financial awards aren't a good test anymore. CFRG review is good enough, and those guys are pretty conservative, they're pretty careful, and they are also are good about soliciting expert, outside experts, and not answering when they don't have an answer. Pardon me? Review, what do you mean by, you'll have to go to the mic and we can discuss, I don't know what you mean by that, but what do you mean review and approval? Well, they were asked, CFRG was specifically asked to pick some things, but they can also be asked to just review some things, right? As opposed to picking out something from Greenfield. Did you wanna, you want me to finish?
Ask a question?
Yeah.
Okay, so Paul Vaucus read that. So why isn't this slide just having one bullet point that says CFRG review and no working group?
Because there are things, that's an interesting question, and maybe that's where we want to go, is funnel everything through the CFRG. That's not necessarily completely their charter, and there may be alternative sources that are we think are good enough. For example, Cha-Cha Poly never really, you know, didn't get much of a CFRG review, but we're basing TLS 1.3, half of it on it. Global competitions, things at AES SHA-3, nobody has found particular problems with that outside of National Cipher Paranoia, CSER, and so on. And then, you know, multiple papers in some of the standard crypto conferences.
You have to, I'd say the Cha-Cha 20 poly 1305 got a lot of review from CFRG. It even got an RFC published by CFRG.
Okay.
Described.
I'm sorry. Yeah, you're right. And in fact, they fixed something that wasn't in the original, but that got added by an outsider that was fixed.
This is your last slide, yes?
I'm done.
Yep. Okay. So Paul Hoffman, I liked Paul Waters' idea of that CFRG. I mean, yes, it's a bottleneck, but this isn't a bad bottleneck for us to have.
Perhaps, Nick, one idea I'd float, Martin will be next, one idea I'd float is maybe it's CFRG's mandatory for is required for MTI crypto.
So actually, you should go to the CFRG meeting if you're interested in this. They're also thinking a bit about this. But I guess, you know, I think what we could expect is some advice from CFRG, but we can't task CFRG to go and do a full analysis of something. They can help us find the literature and give opinions. I think that's possibly true.
Yeah, so Martin Thompson, how does this relate to the recent changes in TLS where we basically open the CipherSuite registries to all comers, but only label those things that we want with a Y?
Sure.
How does that relate to that?
Okay, so for those who don't know, the CipherSuite code point registry is changing, and there'll be an additional column that says, yes, the IETF has come to consensus and recommends this, N, which means no comment. I think it doesn't affect it very much. Yeah, I know. It doesn't affect it very much because it's unlikely that any MTI crypto would ever have an N in it. So I think yes is the first step, and then if it's going to move forward to MTI, it should have what we think is an acceptable level of review.
Yeah, so I'm just wondering whether or not this is a necessary precondition for the Y.
No, I don't think it's a necessary, well, my opinion, obviously we'll have to come to some consensus. No, I don't think it's a necessary precondition for the Y. You have this interesting chicken and the egg problem, in that people don't start attacking things until they're in use and they can get recognition or fame for it. So I think we do need to put out some crypto that we think may not be good enough for MTI or allow protocols to put out crypto. And we're clearly doing that right now with TLS. And also
we,
the
we
reason-
We didn't put anything in TLS that hasn't met this bar in quite a while.
Yes.
There are other areas of the IETF that are less cognizant of that kind of stuff, maybe.
Right. And there are things in TLS that get a no comment that would meet the bar.
Well, that's fine, too. I mean, I'm quite happy saying that right. Such and such, that sort of algorithm, no, not everyone's going to implement it, but it is perfectly fine. But if it's not perfectly fine by these standards, I don't want to be recommending it, and I think that's a reasonable thing to say.
Okay. All right.
You're on?
So to comment on the previous discussion, This is only about MTI, so let's focus on MTI. To the bullet on CFRG review, I think CFRG is very good when they review and approve stuff that has been around the crypto industry, crypto literature for a while, but I wouldn't want to task CFRG with reviewing Greenfield algorithms and saying, yeah, the CFRG has looked at it for 2 or 3 months and now it's fine.
Yeah. Agreed. Yeah. So Martin Thompson, on that point, I think all we need to ask the CFRG is there enough analysis of this algorithm that we can recommend it to someone? And I think that's a reasonable request to make of them.
That's a good question, because it's a fairly simple literature search question by people in the field.
If there is not, and they're unwilling to go off and do the work themselves, then, oh well, too bad.
So as I said, I don't know if Alexei is here, but CFRG will be talking about exactly that tomorrow. Is it tomorrow? I think it's tomorrow.
Tim Polk, NIST. I think it's a lot easier to say what's not good enough, and that's a list that this document can be very, very clear about. Here are the kinds of things that we definitely is not enough. I think depending upon the class of algorithms and the relative level of maturity that any of the other three might or might not be sufficient. I can think of things like stream cipher competition that Etsy did, where one of the algorithms was broken about a year after it was approved. You know, you have to be very careful about what is good enough, because I don't think that's as easy a question. I think that this document is stronger if it gets rid of all the cruft that says, no, these things aren't even worth talking about. And then we can say, in this area, you know, it's block ciphers. We know a lot about block ciphers. We can make really good decisions. Some of the other areas, you know, 10 years ago, hash algorithms were still witchcraft, and you know, most of those have been broken since then. So I think we have to be a little careful about saying, here's the process that's going to work in every case. I think we really want to be talking about, you know, eliminate the bad stuff and then leave ourselves a set of options so that we can tap into the best communities for whatever kinds of algorithms we're doing otherwise.
I think it's a good idea to rely on global competitions and papers, but of these competitions and papers come with a list of caveats, list of assumptions made about the environment where this algorithm is being used. And it's still up to the working group, whether it's TLS or some other working group, to decide whether their environment really meets the requirements of running that algorithm. Just kind of different example, there's this ASGCM SAV that may be a candidate for CFRG soon. So that's kind of like ASGCM, except it has some other nice properties. So does that mean we want that for TLS? And the answer is no, because the new great properties that it has that regular ASGCM doesn't have are totally not interesting for TLS or for IPsec, for that matter. So it's not like the working group can delegate all of the thought of whether an algorithm is good enough for their protocol to CFRG or to definitely not to global competitions.
Okay, I think so we'll cut the line on this topic after Yoav.
Channeling Derek Atkins, but this hurdle is only for MTI crypto. Optional to implement crypto should require a much lower bar. And a comment of my own, please rename the draft.
Sure.
I just one last favor, if the folks who came to the mic could either send me email or go to the GitHub link and raise issues or post them on the SAG list, because there were a lot of detailed comments. It's really excellent feedback. I don't want to lose any of it.
Yes. Thanks. So I think the only other thing to note is that there's no rush with this. It may be something that we want to have a more in-depth discussion about in Berlin, perhaps. So, but please, you know, if you can get comments in, and that'll be great.
Okay, next. Next.
Cool. Thank you. Hello. Before I start talking about NSSEC 5, I want to notice that this is for DNS, DNSSEC, and it doesn't have very wide support in the DNS community. First time I've been talking about this, it was at a SAC meeting in Dallas. We raised some questions, we got some suggestions, and here we are with NSSEC 5 with elliptic curves. And even if this might die in DNS, it might be useful, or some of the concept might be useful somewhere else. So next slide, please. This is just a DNSSEC quick start. DNSSEC brings data authentication into DNS. It is designed in a way that you can do offline signing. So you take your zone, pre-compute the signatures, store them in the zone and use them for answering. If you want to authenticate that something doesn't exist in the zone, we have a mechanism which we call NSSEC. And this is basically how it works. You take all the names in the zone, feed them into some hashing function and get some hashes. You take these hashes, sort them, and then you take each subsequent pairs of these hashes and build a new NSSEC record for each of these pairs and insert them into the zone. So when the server receives a query for some domain name which doesn't exist, the server answers with this NSSEC, and the NSSEC basically says this name doesn't exist because in this name range, no name exists. This works pretty fine. The problem is that, or it raises small security concern, and that's you can enumerate the content of the zone. Next slide, please. So how to prevent zone content enumeration? The first version of NSSEC, or the initial one, used no hashing, so the domain names are in plain text in the NSSEC records, which means that the zone enumeration is really trivial. You just ask for the NSSEC records. NSSEC 3 tries to prevent this by hashing the names which are one, which kind of works. It makes the zone enumeration a bit complicated, but it's still possible with some offline attacks. And NSSEC 5, which is this draft about, brings public key hashing scheme, which makes the zone content enumeration impossible. So next slide, please. The first draft we introduced used RSA full domain hash. The problem with the scheme is that the proofs we are using were really large, which also made the DNS responses very large. And from various reasons, we don't like large responses in DNS. So this is what we asked at the last SAC meeting, at a SAC meeting in Dallas. We were given some hints how to use elliptic curve cryptography, and now we have some custom verifiable random function, which can be used basically with any elliptic curve. We used the NIST curve and the ED25519 curve. And this allowed us to reduce the size of the proofs and the responses. If you are interested into the scheme, please check out the paper, check out the draft. It definitely has some rough edges, and there's definitely some space for improvement. Next slide. We wanted just to make sure that the size with the elliptic curve cryptography in NSSEC 5 really doesn't matter. So we made some measurements. We took some real mid-size zone, assigned it with different algorithms, asked the server some queries and measured the size of the responses. So as you can see, the NSSEC 5 is on the right side. The responses are still a bit larger with NSSEC 5 than with other NSSEC mechanisms. However, what's important is that NSSEC 5 elliptic curves has smaller responses than with NSSEC 3 with RSA with a key size of 1024 bits, which is at the moment the most used algorithm. Next slide, please. And these are just the links to the work we do. The current draft Git repository with the sources. We have a project page where you can find some running code because we have some older version of Node.DNS authors that is server patched to support NSSEC 5 and also some implementation of the cryptography.
Thank you. No questions? Maybe we have one?
Hi, John Dickinson. You said that this isn't getting much traction in the DNS group.
Yes.
So where do you see it being used? if it's not in DNS?
Well, I think that I meant exactly the custom verifiable random function with LPIC versus cryptography, because it's basically a hashing with public key with elliptic curves. I think we don't have anything like that at all.
Okay. This is DKG. I was wondering whether you have any sort of deployment plans.
Deployment?
Like, do you expect people to actually be running this live?
We are not running this live. But we have the code for the authoritative servers. We don't have the validation part.
And is this, if someone was to try to run this live, would you expect them to generate NSEC records and NSEC 3 records and NSEC 5 records?
For which reason? Or maybe I just don't understand the question.
I'm just trying to understand how someone would deploy this, given that there's now three ways to say I have no
It should be
record.
A replacement or an alternative to NSEC or NSEC 3. So.
Okay.
My name is Andrew Sullivan, and I read this, and I think that there is something fetching about it, but I think it's an attractive nuisance. So I think that the reason this isn't getting pickup within the DNS community is because it's another reason not to deploy DNSSEC. It will take a long time. I mean, what we have seen so far with DNSSEC is that it takes practically forever to get things rolled out to what you're talking about. I mean, you just said you don't even have code for validation. So now we're talking about something that is maybe going to be built in the future, and this is a replacement for stuff that is already out there that already isn't getting deployed. Arguably, of course, the reason it's not getting deployed is because of the enumeration story, although I have my doubts, since most zones have about 8 labels in them, and so you can just generate new ones. So I think that this is, my initial reaction was that this is harmless but useless. But I actually think that it undermines the deployment story for DNSSEC, and therefore I think that it isn't a great idea. Finally, I do, sort of to follow up on what John said, it seems sort of mystifying to me why, if you can't get anybody in the DNS community to think that this is interesting, why we think that it would be a good idea to pursue it. Thanks.
Okay, so we're going to cut the lines on this topic as there. Thanks.
Channeling Peter Koch, how would the computational burden change for validators from NSEC 3 to NSEC 5?
It would change. It would be, I think, 10 times higher, maybe 100 times higher. It's it's basically ECDSA validation versus validation of SHA-1 or computation of SHA-1.
John again. I agree with what Andrew said, and I just wanted to add that NSEC 3 was only ever, if I recall correctly, supposed to make zone enumeration roughly as hard as zone enumeration would be in an unsigned zone. It was never meant to be completely unenumeratable.
Well, with NSEC 3, NSEC 3 allows you to enumerate the zone offline. You just get some NSEC 3 record, then you can do some computation, and you will find that some name exists or doesn't exist. But with NSEC or without NSEC, with unsigned zone, you can't enumerate the zone without asking the question to the server.
Yeah, I mean, you can just try all the names you can possibly think of.
But. Yeah. So NSEC 5 and unsigned zone in this S4 zone enumeration is basically the same.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think NSEC 3 is difficult enough. You have to do enough work.
I don't know.
The mic line's closed. You get it.
Dan York, thank you for bringing this research or continuing this research and looking at that. I mean, it's always good to be looking at these things. I think that, to Andrew's point and John's point, the challenge we are looking at certainly right now is the length of time it takes to deploy things within the overall infrastructure of the DNS. Right now we've been looking at how to move elliptic curves into the signatures of DNSSEC and the process that it will take us over the next couple of years to get the EDDNSA or EDDSA keys signatures out into the overall system. I think that the challenge here is that you're looking at adding one more piece into that overall deployment elements of what's going on out there. So I think that's why there hasn't been as much interest. It's just that there's a lot of other pieces that are viewed as having a higher priority in getting deployed out into the system beyond. That would be my suggestion.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next one.
Hi, so I'm Tuomas Aura, and I'm going to talk about out-of-band authentication for EAP. And the reason why I'm talking about it in the SAG meeting is because there didn't seem to be a working group that would be a good match for this. So the background to this story is that for a couple of years we've been working on digital signage and kind of IoT application. And we needed a bootstrapping method for the displays, and we built it on EAP. And then later realized that this could possibly be generalized to a more standard or general use bootstrapping method for IoT appliances. So next slide. But I do realize that this is not the first time someone proposes out-of-band authentication for EAP, and also it's not the I'm not the first one to think about bootstrapping of IoT appliances. But anyway, I would like to suggest that it's a kind of good combination to put the two together. What we have thinking about is cloud-connected IoT appliances, and when I have a new appliance, I just bought it from the shop on the street. It has no owner, no domain, no credentials for any kind of authentication with either a cloud service or a Wi-Fi network. And what I want to achieve is to connect it to an access network to get network and internet connectivity. And I want to register it at the AAA server and in a cloud server. And that's what this EAP method, EAP Noob, does. And where does the security come from? Well, we do Diffie-Hellman and then authenticate it with a single one-directional user-assisted out-of-band message. Next slide. So here is a kind of storyboard what we want the user experience to be like. At the university, I'm hanging up new displays on the wall. I power up one display, and it generates a dynamic QR code, shows it to me. I pick out any smartphone, scan the QR code that takes me to a web page in a cloud server, which is linked to the AAA server. And I log in if I'm not already logged in on the smartphone browser. And that's it. After a few seconds, processing that display is connected to the wireless network. And it is also registered on to a cloud server for the applications. But of course, this doesn't happen magically. There has to be something going on behind. Next slide. So here is a more architectural picture of what is there. There is the infrastructure side. We have the wireless network and AAA. And in our settings, we have like local AAA server that takes care of the access network. And then specific requests, it forwards to a remote AAA server in the cloud. And then we have these IoT appliances, and when they are new, they have no relation with this infrastructure whatsoever. And well, what do we get out of EAP and the out-of-band channel? Next slide. So we have two communication channels. We have the in-band EAP channel, and then we have the user-assisted out-of-band channel. And the appliances are assumed to have either input or output, but not both. So for example, a printer or display might have generated a dynamic QR code. And on the cloud side, web API or web user interface or programmable API. Next slide. So what happens in the background in the display scenario? is that there's two AEPA conversations. So we first run an initial exchange with the EAP server, and then the out-of-band message takes place, in this case scanning the QR code, and then there is the completion exchange after that, that's the next slide. So here is a little bit more detail, but still not the full detail, of course, about the protocol. So the initial exchange does elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman over EAP, then the out-of-band message, which can go in either direction, and then the completion exchange, which does authentication and key confirmation. And all that should take place just once for each device in one domain. And once it's registered, there is the reconnect exchange, which can be then later used for rekeying, algorithm upgrades, and so on. So that's kind of the high level view. And then in the couple of next slides, there's more details. First about the protocol architecture, how we use EAP, and then the security part. So we kind of make creative use of EAP, and I guess this may be some of the most controversial parts of the proposal. Well, because you don't have pre-configured relation between the IEEE, you don't have a relation between the AAA server and the peer device. We need to create it in the process, and for that reason, the device doesn't know which wireless network it should connect to. So if it doesn't have a button for user interface, the user to choose the network, then it may actually probe all the networks and cycle a few, show me a few different QR codes, and I scan the one that I like and the domain that I like, and it connects to one backend server. Then we have split the initial exchange and the completion to two different EAP conversations, which is unusual for an EAP method. But that's because we need time for the out-of-band message to be carried over. That might take longer time. And because we don't have like secure identity for the device in the beginning, and we need to route this request to the cloud AAA server, we always use the network access identifier that is a constant string, noob@eapnoob.net, for the initial exchange. And next slide. So this is the, as much as I have put security here on the slides. So elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman initially unauthenticated, there can be a man-in-the-middle attacker on that. And then we have taken ideas from various device pairing protocols on how to pair, pair now in this case a device and a service in the cloud, like the AAA server. And we use a combination of two security mechanisms in this out-of-band message. There is a secret nonce, and there is a fingerprint of the key, Diffie-Hellman key exchange. And either one alone should kind of be sufficient. So the secret nonce is used in the completion exchange for authentication and key confirmation, so MAC for MAX. And that authenticates the Diffie-Hellman key exchange in both directions. But then we're worried about someone spying on the out-of-band channel. So for example, the QR code, someone could actually have a telescope or long camera and spy that from away, far away. If that would break the security, they could do a man-in-the-middle attack on the in-band channel on the wireless network or internet. And for that reason, we also include the HOOB, which is a fingerprint of the Diffie-Hellman key exchange, and that authenticates the key exchange to the endpoint that receives that, which is typically, like in our example, it is the AAA server. And that, of course, is sufficient for making sure the server is not fooled by spoofing attacks. But then the device doesn't know if the exchange completed or not. And in that case, we rely on the user to notice that the exchange didn't complete on the server. The device was never registered, so that maybe I should go and reset the device. And but that is, of course, that security is only needed if the attacker happens to sniff this secret nonce, noob. So that's kind of the idea here, is that we combine the using a secret in the secrecy of the out-of-band channel and integrity of the out-of-band channel for double protection, so that if one of these fails, both don't fail, and then I think it's a good compromise in a way that we can achieve this single message in one direction. So for example, display that is on the wall, I wouldn't really want to even, so most device pairing protocols would at that point want to confirm the authentication by pressing a single button. So that's the kind of security story. Is there a burning question?
Yep, covered. So the problem you are trying to solve is the case where we had a couple of incidents where, for example, surveillance, home surveillance cameras or baby cameras were had a default password and then they got compromised or keys got extracted from those. So the challenge is many of the networks don't use EAB to begin with. So the EAB story is a challenge.
That's true. For home networks, it's a question that you would need to use EAB.
In home networks, you don't use EAB, which people don't do, and that's particularly where the problems are, because the challenge that these people have is they don't want some new technology being introduced into the home. For other radio networks like IEEE 802.15.4, for Bluetooth and some other of these low-power wide area networks, there is also no EAB, but there's a different story for providing similar functionality. It's the terminology is a little bit different. What they call bootstrapping is typically what we would call key distribution. What the term that they use instead for this purpose is onboarding. And there are different stories. So if you look at Thread, for example, they use a password-based authenticated key exchange in DLS. Something similar, also DLS-based, is used by OIC for this onboarding functionality. But it's onboarding with having basically no credentials for network access is only one part of the story, because typically it was on one of your earlier slides. You said there are no credentials or nothing, a completely blank device with no credentials to the server side, to the cloud infrastructure. Yeah, yes. And typically that's not the case.
So what we are trying to achieve here is like compare the passwords, a minimal user interface, just scan one code. So something where you don't need to build an extra user interface into the IoT appliance.
I understand that, and I'm saying for the scenarios that you want to solve, that won't work because people want to integrate it into existing networks, and the downside of doing that, they have this vulnerability. For the other cases, it's not necessary to do that because they already have mechanism, or in the industrial environment, they use something totally different. So you EAB is a sort of the solution, so there's no problem.
Well, the question is how many such devices are and how often you are deploying and redeploying them. So the idea that, you know, we were afraid that if you need to manually configure something or you rely on some pre-distributed credentials in the devices or in the cloud, between the devices and your cloud service, then or your network, then you need a professional administrator. So if you think, like in this case, anyone could go and buy those displays, hang them on the wall, and they just need a user account within the organization, and basically like university login, and they can add their device.
So the mic line's closed for this one, and if we can be relatively brief, that'd be good. We don't have to rush off, but.
Bob Moskowitz, it's a good first step. I've worked last summer with one vendor, has no screen in which to display QR code. We had to work with QR codes which were etched into the sensors. And so you have to look at how you would work from a static QR code. And as Han just said, you also need to look at where you have devices that can't support EAP and other things because you only got 32K of memory.
Clearly is for appliances that have either input or output user interface of a few hundred bits. So,
yeah.
And
we can take it to the next step. And we'll see where it goes from here. Thank you very much, though, for the work you have done. I've been a long-time proponent of QR codes in a manner similar to this. So thank you.
Thank you for the...
One
more question.
Dan Harkins. So you're doing EAP from this headless device or device with limited UX, right? And it's going back to some cloud server. So that means that at the end of the EAP exchange, the cloud is going to have a PMK for all of these devices, that's going to be a very attractive place to attack because he will be able he knows the secret that's used to provision and control all of these devices in your house.
That's exactly what we want because that's the server that we use for managing those devices. Of course, not in my house, but let's say in my university, of course that server may be at the university if we want to keep it local. But I guess some people might want to outsource that to the cloud, really. And there's a couple of extensions that have been requested, so like roaming support. How would you configure the bootstrap the device when I'm roaming on EduRoam here in Buenos Aires? I think we can do that in two steps. And then vendor certificates could give us some more assurance, like telling apart difference between a physical device and a virtual device.
Okay. So I guess if you're interested in this, I guess comment to the authors and I guess comments on the SAG list if you want to support progressing this somewhere would probably be the best thing for now.
Yeah, and my question is like, where should we continue with this and is anyone else interested? Thanks.
Thank you. So, Grant. Fernando. So if you give it to 15, 20 minutes, great.
Okay. Okay, so hello, this is Fernando Gont presenting an internet draft that we co-author with Ivan Arce. He's present here in this room. It's a document on the security and privacy implications of numeric identifiers employed in network protocols. Next slide. So why are we talking about this idea? Essentially, both Ivan and me have been doing quite a lot of work over the years on the security and privacy implications on numeric IDs. And if you look back into protocols and implementations for the last years, most of the identifiers in different protocol specifications and implementations have suffered from security and privacy implications. Some examples are TCP initial seconds numbers, transport protocol numbers, IPv4 and IPv6 fragment identifiers, IPv6 interface identifiers, DNS transaction IDs, and so on. Something that is interesting is that the lessons that were learned from one protocol were not applied in some other protocol. One possible example is the use of predictable fragment IDs in IPv4, and later the use of predictable fragment IDs in IPv6. And at the same time, when some of these issues were fixed in one protocol, they were reinstantiated in a different protocol. Next slide. So this is a sample timeline just for one single protocol. What's interesting is that when you look at this specific protocol, you realize that it took about 30 years to actually get this fixed. But when you think this in a more global way, at the same time, we were working on, the problems with predictable TCP initial seconds number. We had issues with predictable DNS transaction IDs, predictable fragment IDs, and so on. So as long ago as September 1981, we had RFC 793, which suggested the use of a global 32-bit counter. To produce the TCP initial seconds numbers. And only 4 years after that, February 1985, Morris essentially described how these predictable ISNs could be exploited. A few years after that, 1999, Stephen Bellavin published a paper that discussed not only the implications of predictable ISNs, but also of other predictable IDs. 10 years later than the Morris paper, there was a very widely publicized exploitation of this problem. Next slide. 1996, we're talking 10 years later after the original discussion, there was the publication of RSC 1948, which was the first solution that was proposed to this problem, but it was an informational document, not a formal update to the protocol standard. March 2001, Zaleski published a report which noted that some implementations that supposedly were generating good ISNs were actually weak. May 2001, there were at least two vulnerability advisories noting that this was affecting real implementations. Next slide. March 2002, there's a report by Michael Zaleski, which is quoted here, and says, while some vendors reacted promptly and tested their solutions properly, many still either ignored the issue and never evaluated the implementations or implemented a flawless solution that apparently was not tested using a known approach. February 2012, we get to publish RFC 6528. That's kind of like almost 27 years later after the original problem was discussed. This document formally updated RFC 793. And in August 2014, we finally are incorporating this into the core TCP specification. This didn't just happen for TCP. This is a single example. At the same time, we were doing the same thing for Fragment IDs, or even nowadays for IPv6 addresses. Next slide. So what we tried to do is, you know, we were seeing that the same problem was being experienced in, you know, different versions of different protocols. And we tried to, you know, figure out, well, what can we do to actually, you know, prevent this from happening again? Next slide. So we produced this ID, which essentially talks about numeric identifiers. We refer, we say that it's, we use the term numeric identifiers as a generic term. In some cases, it could be a fragment ID. In other cases, it could be, let's say, a seconds number. In other cases, it could be an interface identifier. And we know that in most of these cases, these identifiers have specific interoperability or specific characteristics that need to be fulfilled for interoperability reasons. So in some cases can be uniqueness. In other cases, these identifiers need to be monotonically increasing. In others, they need to be stable within some context. Next slide. And given these interoperability requirements, there is a severity of the failure associated when you actually don't meet them. So in some cases, if you don't meet those requirements, there is a hard failure. It's a problem that you cannot recover from. Could be, for example, a resetted TCP connection. In other cases, there could be a soft failure, which means, for example, that just a single packet gets dropped, but you know, if you retransmit the same packet, you know, things go fine. Next slide. So what's the root cause of this problem? I mean, why is it that, you know, so many different protocols got the identifiers wrong, and how is it that, you know, different implementations got these identifiers wrong? Next slide. So on one hand, we have specifications that under-specify the requirements for the identifiers. So they just specify the interoperability requirements, but they don't do any security and privacy analysis of those identifiers. Examples are the TCP port numbers, the ISNs and 793, or even the DNS transactions ID in RFC 1035. There are other cases in which these identifiers are over-specified. That's the case, for example, of IPv6 interface identifiers, in which we are requiring to, for example, include a MAC address in the interface ID when that's not really needed. We only need a number that is unique. There's the same thing with the fragment ID generator in RFC 2460. It describes that you should probably generate the fragment ID as a global counter, which obviously is a bad idea. And as a third example, it's just implementations that simply fail to comply with the specified requirements. Next slide. So what we try to do is, based on the identifiers that we know, try to see if we know if we could categorize them and see, well, we have these different types of identifiers with this set of requirements, and try to figure out if we could come up with algorithms that could fulfill those interoperability requirements and at the same time mitigating or minimizing the security and privacy implications. Next slide. So first thing that we did is try to, for some sample set of identifiers, figure out what are the interoperability requirements and what's the failure severity when you actually don't meet those requirements. So you have different cases here. So for example, in the case of the IPv6 fragment ID, the requirement is obviously uniqueness for the address pair. And the failure severity can be soft or hard. Obviously, if it's just a single packet that gets dropped, a single collision, no problem at all. But obviously, if systematically you get collisions, obviously it results in a hard problem. Obviously, the draft has details regarding why we decided or assessed that the failure severity is soft or hard in each case. Next slide. So based on the interoperability requirements and on the failure severity, we came up with these four different categories, okay? The idea was to try to come up with as many categories as necessary, but as few as necessary, to try to categorize all of the identifiers that we know of so that we could, first of all, analyze if the current specifications or current specifications are doing the right thing or not, and at the same time to produce algorithms that if you had an identifier of this sort, you could use such that you could achieve those requirements without actually having negative security and privacy implications. So categories are uniqueness with soft failure, which means unique. You need a unique number, but if there's a collision, there's no problem at all. Uniqueness with the hard failure, in which case you don't want those values to collide. I mean, if they collide, you get into problems. Uniqueness and constant within some context. That can be, for example, the case of the interface IDs that you use for stable IPv6 addresses. So you have to select a number that is unique in the local network. But if there's a collision, you can recover. You detect the collision and you can recover for that. So it's not a hard error. The other case is uniqueness, monotonically increasing within the context. And that's the case of TCP, ISN. And it results in a hard failure. The details are in this ID. For those that are TCP experts, if you don't do monotonical increase in ISNs, you may fail to establish some connections because of some heuristics that are implemented in BSDs, for example. Next slide. And next slide. So what our document does is for each of these categories propose a set of algorithms that can meet the interoperability requirements without security and privacy implications. But we also discuss some algorithms that have been used either in protocol specifications or in implementations, and we discuss what are the impact of those. The goal of having these algorithms here is that so that if in the future there's a protocol that is specified that needs a specific kind of identifier, if your numeric ID falls into any of the categories that or into one of the categories that we have specified here, you have at least one option that has been evaluated and that doesn't have negative security and privacy implications. Next slide. And next slide. So besides the specific advice on algorithms, we envision that like high level specific set of requirements could be included as part of, for example, what are currently the security considerations of RFCs or internet drafts, which means that if there is a document that is specifying identifiers, then you should follow these three steps that are here. First of all, clearly specify what are the interoperability requirements for your ID, and that is going to make it easier for the community to figure out whether the algorithm that you are proposing actually meets the interoperability requirements that you have, but doesn't have any, you know, security and privacy implications. All documents should have a security and privacy analysis of this of the corresponding identifiers. And obviously, they should recommend an algorithm that actually achieves those requirements without having negative security and privacy implications. So besides the analysis, we think that whenever you have an identifier, you should propose at least a default algorithm that doesn't have the implications that we note here. Otherwise, it is up to the implementers which algorithm they select. And at times, these people are programmers that maybe are working in so many different areas but are not experts in this area. Next slide. And next slide. So our question is how to proceed with this document? Where? How? I guess we are asking advice of the chairs and of the group too.
Sure. So I guess the draft, the internet draft, does have an intended status BCP. So I think there's two possibilities. One is we might go down that road, or we might consider this as an informational document. I think if it's going to be an informational document, there may be some interest in the IAB security and privacy program in taking it under that kind of label.
I think informational would be a bad idea.
Sure.
What we want is, you know, to actually require implementations to take care of this. Otherwise, it's repeating the story again, and we will probably come back 10 years from now saying, well, that, you know, there was someone that published that, but, you know, since it wasn't required, you know, specifications were still doing the wrong thing. I mean, we do 40 years of what we have been doing in 30 years.
Sure. You know, I mean, there's an argument that there's some, that there might be a space for BCP here. So how many people have read this document? A few. Does anybody have an opinion as to whether this would be better targeted as a BCP or an informational document? And I think we would need more people having read it and commenting before we would go down the BCP route first, though.
Hi, Elliot Lear, and of course, Fernando, I think, as I said earlier, I think this is great work. I think you have some recommendations in there that are really good, but I think this does tie to 3552, as I mentioned to Stephen, and Stephen probably needs volunteers to help at least see if we're ready for a 3552 bis in terms of security considerations, requirements, requirements that document. I think this document as a whole, I would rather capture the key points that are in this document more crisply in a broader document is my personal preference.
Okay. Broader as in terms of what? Whoa.
Like the rest of security considerations. Like they all need a good, that document needs a dust off and a review anyway. So I'm sure there's room for somebody to do something there. Not that I'm volunteering.
Ted Hardy, somewhat along the same lines, I think what would be really good is to take the threats that are in this and some of the threats that have been identified and people will be sharing with you, like the linkability threats, and publish those as informational. And then in a BIS document of 3552 or in some other thing, say, hey, well, before you write your security considerations, here's an informational document that you should point to read, because it won't be best current practice to apply specific mitigations for every time. It's simply information somebody should have on what the classes of threats are before they take on the responsibility. So I think the threat portion of it would be a great informational document to be worked on here or in some other part of the security area. And then people who are writing security considerations can read it. And if there are specific mitigations that we believe are best current practice, those kind of go into something separate, whether it's a rev of an existing document or a different document.
So as a clarification, so what you envision is essentially take the last piece of the advice into the document that describes how to write security considerations, then to have a part of the document, the one that describes the known attacks, to in an informational document, and the set of recommended algorithms into a BCP.
That's probably too fine-grained for.
Yeah, that's probably a bit too fine-grained. But the point I was really getting at was that the attacks themselves should remain in an informational document because they'll rev faster, right? Than either the you should consider attacks in your security considerations, or potentially faster than the set of mitigations does.
Hi, my name's Tim Shepard, and I was just trying to read as much of the document as I could while you were giving your talk and also listen to you. And I just want to say that as far as I can tell, the parts that I quickly dug into and read in it, there's a lot of good information in this document that to me clearly belongs in informational RFC. In particular, I was looking to where you explained the history of TCP initial sequence number. In some sense, you're collecting together what's already elsewhere, and it doesn't need to be in a BCP, and it doesn't need to be in a proposed standard because you point at where it is. But it's a very good informational sort of document to survey, and in some sense, perhaps the document as it is. Anyway, I just want to say that there should definitely be an informational that results from this, and I'm not saying anything about whether there should also be a smaller BCP or a smaller even proposed standard or anything, because I haven't digested all of it. So I'm just saying thumbs up to the yes, an informational should result.
Okay.
Okay, so I guess a few people have said it, so let me just figure out if there's a general agreement about that. So RFC 3552 is a BCP, isn't it? And it's from 2003, it's BCP 72. I'm just going to ask for a home as to whether people think we should look at updating that in the next time that the area directors can get around to doing it mostly. But so if you think we should update RFC 3552 and include these kind of considerations and so on, please home now. If you think we should not, please home now. Okay, so there wasn't overwhelming enthusiasm, but there was no opposition. So I guess Kathleen and I will chat and see where we think to go next to that. And in the meantime, I guess, Fernando, you can, we'll keep talking to you about it.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, next up is Elliot and friends, I guess.
Hello. So I'm here with Michael Berenger and Hannes to talk about some work that a few of us have been doing. It's very much related to the work that we saw at the beginning of this session. It's also work that is related to some of the stuff that Stefan Winter presented in OPSEC, as I've just learned. Next slide, please. So a couple of classic problems. Obviously, we're hitting problem of scale with the number of things that we're going to hit the internet. This is actually not the number that scares me. That thing, by the way, is 50 billion by 2020. That one doesn't bother me. Next slide. So the reason it doesn't bother me is when you have one vendor that's supporting hundreds of millions of systems already in just one vendor. So you have to take the first number, billions of devices with a certain grain of salt. The thing that really bothers me actually, and the thing that's really concerning me, is scaling the number of types of devices. And now I work at a network vendor, so I look at profiling systems and things like that. Try profiling the sheer numbers of devices that are coming out, and that begins to get daunting. Next slide. So there are a couple dimensions of this problem. One of the dimensions is what sort of environment these systems are built for. On the one hand, you have something like an oil well where you sink a device down for 10 to 40 years, and you can amortize the cost of any sort of configuration pretty quickly. On the other hand, you have a healthcare system where the device has to, what the patient needs, what the patient needs, when the patient needs it, and even a delay on getting a device to the patient can be life-threatening, and you cannot amortize the cost of configuration, let alone have any time to configure. Next slide, please. So in this context, the thing I've been looking at is basically two pieces of information. What is the device? And how do we protect it? So the discussion we're going to have here is broken down into that framework. And then Hannes is going to also give an alternate view in one slide in 10 parts, perhaps. Next slide. So there is some work going on in the IETF on all of this already. Michael's going to talk about the ANIMA bootstrapping work that's going on. Hannes has the ACE working group, which is also looking in this space. There's a zero-touch deployment draft by Kent Watson
That's looking at what the device is. And then I'm working on something called MUD, and Dan Romascano has something known as auto-attach, and then we can also add in to something that sort of takes all this into account, which is the work that Stefan Winter is doing. Next slide, please. Okay, Michael Behringer, where are you?
Yeah, thanks. Okay, thanks. Okay, move the slides. Thanks. So this is about a draft that we've been working on for 3 years now. It's in the Anima working group, and it explains how to bootstrap a device into a network zero touch, so you don't have to do anything on the device up front, with the possibility to authenticate the network as well. Next slide, please. So it's very similar to the draft that we just saw earlier, some subtle differences, so I have to read that one. I haven't read it yet. The problem case is we have a device that comes from factory. It has not been pre-staged. So today what we do in traditional networking is a lot of pre-staging in IoT with millions of devices. I think that is not feasible. The goal is that you zero touch that device into your network. You make that join the network in a secure way. So it is that device that's joining your network and not another. And at the same time that the new device can actually make sure it joins the correct network. So there is a step whereby the network will, the new device will only join the network it's supposed to join. And again, that is for large scale IoT environments, probably a must rather than a should in a requirement in the future. So the philosophy that we have, and that's where our Anima work is slightly different from many of the other works. We are not trying to download a config. We are giving a device a domain certificate, a certificate that's valid within that network domain. And with that, then it can secure whatever else it wants to do, and that is really outside scope for us here in this particular discussion. Here's the enrollment process as we have designed it 3 years ago about. We have the first implementations of that. We have an updated version of that right now. So if you read the current version, it's actually slightly different. But I still have the slide in because it shows the concept that we are trying to establish. So first of all, a new device in our model does not require any form of addressing. We do not require DHCP or anything. We require link local addressing and nothing else. So the new device will not be able to reach anything directly until it actually is accepted in the domain. I think that's a first strong point. Then there's some exchange of identities and some subtle differences here in the latest draft, but essentially the new device sees what's around it, and if it sees a device with a domain, it will try to join that domain. Since it has no knowledge, it is factory default, it can at this point not tell which device it should join, but we can make the process fail if it's the wrong one, and then you iteratively go through the devices. Since we only have link local in our approach, we need a proxy, and that proxy now needs to find a central point where we know which device belongs where. This is this what we call a registrar. On the registrar, we need a list of our devices, quote unquote, so serial numbers, whatever. And then you can make a local decision. Now we have introduced a concept called the Manufacturing Authorized Signing Authority, MASA. That's a cloud-based vendor service where the vendor can attest a number of various things. And so there are many different options here now with varying degrees of resulting security. In its strongest form, the vendor server can attest this device has been bought by customer X. That goes back as what we call an authorization token to the registrar in the domain, so to a central point in the domain, and then an enrollment process follows, basically. So you send the information down to the new device that has now the possibility to evaluate this authorization token and only if everything is correct, it will join and does a traditional certificate enrollment. So only link local can only, if something goes wrong, can only attack on the first hop. All the transactions are proxied. I'll also show that in a bit more detail. We suggest cryptographic authentication of the new device via ADA 2.1 AR. The new device can also authenticate the network by this authorization token, which is proxied through from the vendor service. Again, this is not a must requirement. You don't have to have this vendor service, but probably in IoT, this will turn out to be a requirement in my opinion. Next one. So we drove this past various people we know and asked them about their feedback. And so one of the most stringent security requirements we found was in the factory floor where there's strict zoning and you want to make sure that nothing breaks. And I'm not going to go through there, but you can essentially map this model into the factory floor, a sort of a demilitarized zone in the middle, and the internet. And we believe the model still holds and works in that environment. So this is these are the protocols that we are thinking about right now. Disclaimer: nothing of that is cast in stone right now. But we are getting there. So we would really invite feedback from this group on choice of protocols, this order or the other. Many of the things we are doing here can be done slightly differently. This message can come before, can come after. So there are quite a lot of degrees of freedom in there. We would ideally like this to work in an IoT environment. The protocols as they are now may not. Right? So all of that needs to be discussed, and we would invite that discussion. That's the main point. Other than that, I'm not going to go through all the protocols here. I think this is probably too much. MDNS discovery first to find the proxy. Then we have a signaling protocol in Anima that we call GRASP that runs over a secure out-of-band channel. Not out-of-band. Secure overlay network. It looks like an out-of-band channel, but it's not out-of-band. It finds the registrar. There is an enrollment from the device proxied on the proxy that goes through the registrar. Then you start a DTLS with the server certificate that you get, that you accept provisionally. In other words, you don't know it's the right server certificate because you don't know your domain at this point. But let's assume for now it is the right one, and we go through. So then you request a certificate with your .1AR certificate. This registrar can then validate the .1AR certificate, say, yes, this is the correct, this is my device, in other words, can accept it. The new device requests an audit token. Next slide, please. Now comes this vendor service interaction here, which is optional. It's not required. And in some environments, it is preferable or it is not acceptable to do that at the time the device enrolls. You can actually also do this upfront. Also, that has security implications. All of that is in the draft. So the registrar would then go out to the internet-based cloud service, would say, here is my domain, here is the device ID, is this my device? Get some tokens back. You can make then a decision whether you accept the device or not. The tokens get passed on to the new device. The new device looks at the ownership voucher and says, yes, my vendor has said this is the right network, so I can join this network. And therefore, the device, if it's not the right network, it will disconnect and try the next one. And then normal EST or other certificate enrollment can happen. Next one, please. Thank you. So there are a number of other approaches that we need to sort of see if and how we can bring those together. And some progress has been made, but we are not completely on the same page yet. Sixish has discussions on how to do an enrollment process. They are talking DTLS co-op. This is not currently our set of protocols, so we need to see whether we can support those and how. Also, Sixish uses IDEF ID, which is, we are using that as well, NetConf as well, by the way, so everything starts with the IDEF ID. Sixtish also derives an LDEF ID that uses that for link encryption specifically. which we could do too. So that is not a big difference. And the goal finally is to transport some yang down to the device. In Anima, the goal is to get the LDAP ID, the domain certificate. What you do with that is a different matter outside scope. In NetConf, the primary goal is, well, NetConf to bring some configuration across, so to do some yang transport these days. Again, slight difference here, but not a massive one. NetConf supports a whole range of protocols for the new device to connect. And we have .1x. There, the problem is the device needs to know upfront which network it needs to join.
Thank you, Michael. Stick around. We'll do questions at the end. So then the next part of this is, okay, now the device is connected. How should the network protect it? Next slide, please. So I'm going to just review a couple of quick assumptions. The first assumption is that in this context, a thing, and because I'm not trying to solve the problem for everything, is a device with a single number, a single function, or a small number of uses. And the other assumption is that we can start simple and allow for richer capability later. The third is that no matter what the thing is, it can probably use some form of network protection, even if it's just DDoS protection. And the fourth is that network administrators always are the kings or queens of their castles. This leads to certain assertions. Because a thing is has a single or small number of uses, all other uses can be said to be unintended. And therefore, any intended use can be clearly identified, and the manufacturer is a good person or good organization to or entity to identify those things. And so this is very much analogous to, say, an aspirin bottle where you pull out the usage label and says, okay, here's what this thing is intended for, here's how you use it, and you can go off label if you want. Next slide, please. So in network speak, this roughly translates, and I say roughly, into classic access lists, which, you know, it's a lot of existing work here, clearly. This dates back to prehistoric times. Next slide, please. And the way we get there is in order for the manufacturer, who is in a good position to say all this, to tell us about it, the device needs to put out a URI. So we have a URI. Next slide, please. So the device puts out a URI, and eventually it gets, you know, either through a AAA server, a DHCP server, or some such, to a controller of some form or network management station. MUD controller can then just resolve that URI and go and pull a MUD file server, the file from a MUD file server. What does that file look like? Next slide. Looks like a whole lot of, XML, but this is actually Yang-based XML. There are a number of different approaches that were presented at this IETF, but I want to point out right now that this a Yang-based model that is actually retrieved using HTTPS is not how Yang was envisioned. So we're doing things a little weirdly, and that requires some attention, particularly to security and extensibility. Next slide, please. So now the MUD controller has the thing. It can just instantiate that policy into the access switch. Now that policy is somewhat abstracted, because if the policy is meant for many, many thousands and millions of deployments, obviously you don't want to stick IP addresses in there. So the NetMod working group has been working on access list model, but it all deals with IP addresses. So the model that you saw just extends a little bit to say things like, let me have access to my controller. Let me have access to devices of the same type of manufacturer. Let me have access to a specific host name on the internet, for instance. All that stuff isn't in the ACL model today, but it's very small extensions to be able to get there. One of the design objectives here is to reuse as much code as possible because I'm lazy. Next slide. So here's why all the work is going on. Things are getting sprayed a little bit around the IETF because I'm looking for experts in the right places. You know, the modeling people, I'm not a model person, so I went to NetMod working group. And I'm coming here actually because there are two different types of authentication that could occur in order to get the URI, many types. And if you're using ETLS, then an AR certificate is ideal in this context. But things have very small footprints for memory, so it may be that you can't actually get a whole EAP stack into a very, very small thing. And I've had arguments over 20 bytes with some of the people involved. So DHCP provides a second best option and does provide some protection even so. Next slide. So I've actually just covered all this. We'll just go right to the next slide.
There's a bunch of open questions. We have to figure out again how to, there's some more specification of the mud file that's required, that model needs to evolve a little bit. Extensibility is a challenge because models in Yang, the way that netconf works is you do a capabilities exchange. That capabilities exchange is not so easy when you're just dealing with HTTPS. You have to do tricks with manifest files, and I don't want to do that the first time around because it's quite complex. So we're going to start with something more simple, I think. But we could definitely use more advice there. Let's see here. Then, of course, because these things are going to have very broad impact, they have to be signed. And exactly what those signatures look like, what the subject is, who the signer is, all that stuff has to be reviewed. And then we have a constraint that we're defining. It's non-critical. One of the things I need help with is I need eyeballs on that to make sure that it looks correct. And right now we're trying to help out the Anima group with the work that Michael just presented to provide a discovery point for the master server. And you can do that either by sticking that in the mud file or by creating a separate constraint, and some thought needs to be put into there. And then, again, more protocol review of Anima is hopeful. Next slide. Okay, and that's Hannes.
My presentation is a little shorter. It's one slide. So I wanted to briefly tell you a little bit about what we did at Arm and this sort of concept. We've been working on a together with others in the Open Mobile Alliance on what is called the lightweight M2M protocol, lightweight machine-to-machine communication protocol, which is a device management solution. The OMA has previously worked on one for mobile phones, which had been used there, so seemed to be a natural place to go to, and reuses lots of the IETF technology that was worked on in for example, the core working group with CoAP, also DTLS, and the resource directory also comes from the core working group. And so how this works is you have the client sitting on the device, which is basically used to establish a connection to a server, wherever that server may be. It may be in your local network, local enterprise at home, maybe in your cloud-based infrastructure. And it allows you to do remotely manage that device, provides a couple of features, not just for diagnostics, but also firmware update. It sort of allows you to keep track of what the devices do, and also with resource direct allows you to upload that data to, for example, sensor readings to whatever server you want to. So you actually use it to, on one hand, to manage the device, on the other hand, to actually do whatever application semantics you have been working on. Pretty much a directly copy from the core working group. And various objects have been defined during that process to describe the different type of metadata and the data that comes from that device. So if you go, if you download the slides and click on the link, you will be redirected to the registry that the OMA has established, which lists all these different objects, which include sort of the obvious things for sensors and actuators, but also software update related information, firmware versions, and information about the device. There's not necessarily something that Elliot had been talking about directly, like this manufacturer usage description. But it's pretty close to it, and presumably manufacturer may want to use such a service because they want to keep track of those devices. If you think about, or they delegate it to someone else, of course. What I also want to mention is a tutorial available in case you're not familiar with that mechanism. We had a tutorial session at the ACE working group to talk about this at the end of last year. There's a recording to it. It talks more about the security aspects that Michael had been talking about earlier. But I guess you will get the idea. So this mechanism doesn't tell you exactly on where the server should be located, whether they are the best place in the network, or whether the best place like literally in the access network, or whether that's better be dealt with at some backend infrastructure. But of course, with appropriate permissions, you can get access to the data that is stored, the metadata that is stored. So instead of dumping it into a certificate, you actually have the data in that sort of repository. And there's some, obviously, some real-time data on how the device behaves or misbehaves. And what we also work on is, in addition to securing or providing that data and then do sort of analysis on if something goes wrong, faults, or other things, you obviously need to work on the device security to actually then, if you do a firmware or if you need to do a firmware update, you would have to do it or figure out if, for example, if you have software that is, you have a developer, you built your embedded software, so whether to know whether the device, for example, is subject to attack, you need to know, it's like, is one of your software modules that you use for that device or one of your libraries, is that compromised? So you better know like what's installed on that device to begin with. So you can actually then identify whether you have the most appropriate version among all these different devices that you have rolled out, and then ship the software update to that device. So not just figuring out whether something is wrong, but actually being in a position to do something about it. And of course, the final story is to secure the device itself, getting away from what I describe a flat operating system model, memory model, where a single buffer overflow can compromise the whole device. So instead, moving to a model which is sort of known from a sort of modern operating system or more modern hardware, where you actually have compartmentalization, and so you run certain components in a different isolated space. And we've released what we call a trust zone for our V8M architecture end of last year. So the technology release, so there are no chips available, but if you search for trust zone for V8M, you will find the information. So you also need to do something there, otherwise there's nothing in the network or elsewhere where you can do something about a compromised device system.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And that's pretty much what we wanted to talk about and give you sort of an overview of some things that were going on. And with that, I'd take questions, and I hope that Michael and Hannes will as well. Michael, Hannes, can you come up as well, just for now?
Bob Moskowitz, I've been following this work on the sidelines all along, but I'm working with vendors, work with one vendor that implementing EC25519, elliptic curve DH, 9 seconds in which they consider to be highly optimized code. And that's the best crypto I could get them to do. Anything else they just could not do in their chip, and we use Blake 2 for the hashing again because of what we need to conserve. You're doing very good work on the what you call the class 3 up, but I guess I'm dealing with class 4 and class 5 devices. Mm-hmm. And okay. I like to see more work for what may be more of those millions and billions of devices, which are still going to be very, very small.
So the stuff that I presented, that work, it uses a variety of different credential types. So it's not just public key crypto, but also, and it uses raw public key, it uses certificates, and it also allows you to use shared secrets. We would like to push people to use public key crypto instead of shared secrets for the obvious security benefits. But of course, as you said, there is a performance downside to it. However, the performance investigations that I have done on the Cortex M class processors gave me the impression, and I have presented that in the LB group last year or so, and I can send a pointer to the list again about this, that the performance on those processors is just fine. So maybe your customer or your vendor uses the wrong chips.
It is their own chips, and they're 8-bit processors.
I sound like a salesperson, but sometimes if you want certain properties then there is no free lunch.
Yes.
So you in some sense, I'm tempted to say you pay for those properties, but in fact, you actually get away cheaper because if you use an off-the-shelf processor, it's like the same for many of the things that we see networking, use off-the-shelf equipment, you get away much cheaper than designing your own high-speed stuff because there's a lot of time and development that needs to go into that.
Just letting you know that the stuff is out there. There's lots and lots of it. I think I'm soon going to be walking into yet another hellstorm of even smaller stuff. And I'm looking again for the really small solutions because I'm literally looking at walking into, like I said, something really significant, again, in the very, very small, very, very custom-built processors.
Yeah. So we would like to get people to use sort of standard internet protocols, maybe with different profiles, and use those. And the benefit of doing that is there are various benefits. The first one is you obviously have a lot of security expertise in a room. Lots of people go through to work on the TLS standards. And so there's, you will get the best of what is available with lots of expert review. But there's also a lot of code available, the open source code. And your developers don't need to actually then customize everything. And I think this the ability to bring this stuff faster to market will be a huge win, in my opinion, compared to going for some really specialized solutions.
Other questions?
So I have a question. I guess two questions. One is what bits of work do you see doing in the ITF? And the second one's a comment, is that, you know, it's not surprising that as people who sell things, you keep wanting every piece of equipment to call home to the manufacturer. But not every manufacturer might be equally trustworthy or available or whatever. So are there solutions in that space where you've got a vendor who might not be in business in 6 months?
Two questions.
The second one's a comment.
So the mechanism that I presented doesn't require long-term connectivity from the vendor. It can be there if they want it, but it doesn't require it. So if the vendor's there to begin with, that's great. Michael, when he presented, pointed out that the vendor also doesn't need to be there in the flow, though there is value to having that vendor there. So that's one thing. The other question that you asked, and I know Michael wants to get here, is what work needs to be done in the ITF? There's actually a slide that was back there. There's something particular that I need. There are a couple of things in particular that I'm hoping to get from SAG. The first is that I really do need eyes on the constraint personally, that for MUD. I think that work clearly is new and really does deserve needs more review. The second thing is that this notion of using a NetMod or Yang-based models in a more static setting without netconf poses some new tricks that we have to get through. Like how should those objects be signed? As I mentioned earlier, I think that's a pretty big deal that needs a lot of eyes. So those are the two aspects. The NetMod work is going on in the NetMod working group, and there's a DHCP option which we're not quite sure where the home should be yet. And then there's the constraint, Michael.
Yeah, same here. We don't require the vendor service. There are also ways to pass on that to another party if necessary. You have some, some in-between service that sort of mediates between potential signing authorities. So there are ways of dealing with it. They come at a price, right? If you want the device to be factory shipped yet only connect to the right network, there's got to be something you have to do. Yeah. But it's all flexible. For second question, what do we need to do in the ITF? I would really solicit feedback from this audience on these Anima drafts. We are working on them right now. We would like them to be as widely applicable as possible, and would appreciate your feedback.
Okay. Yeah. So just
okay, I wanted to respond to you.
Oh, okay.
For some of the things, there's the notion of what's the manufacturer, what's the vendor is a very complicated one in this whole space because there are typically many different manufacturers and in different stages for different parts of the whole thing. The, one of the problems, if you look at the bigger picture, which includes the software update mechanism, you somehow have to contact the guy who gives you the software update. And if you look at your smartphone, you are not writing your own software update. So it comes from the guy who provides you that functionality. And so that's something to take into account with all the negative sides that come along with it. So it just doesn't, even if it's an open source, it needs to come from somewhere. You can contribute to it, but most likely the regular end customer is not going to troubleshoot, configure his devices, update firmware manually. He probably doesn't want that. But the tools obviously allow you to do that if you want so. The protocols are like regular standardized protocols. When I give a class about this at the university, we set up a local server and people can sort of play around it. But for most end customers, that would probably be out of the reach. For industrial side, for enterprises, they prefer to have their own servers in their premises, but it's a different deployment story. So you have dedicated guys responsible for this. Standardization wise, we don't really want people to use certificates. Instead, to use something a little bit more modern. Most of the stuff in certificate is pretty meaningless for the IoT devices anyway. So,
just before you go, Thomas, where are the blue sheets? So if you have them, if you could pop them back up here, that'd be great if you haven't signed them. And secondly, if we want a bit of time for open mic, we can continue this discussion, but if you have an open mic topic, just get in line and say something that these guys don't care about. And with that, we got like 10 minutes left, so. Thomas?
So I wanted to point out that when you redeploy a used device, it should work exactly the same way as on the first time. So the case shouldn't be that you have vendor support for the first time for the first customer who bought a new device, but the same process should be repeatable. And that's why it may not be so wise to depend on the vendors, even though you might get some additional value from vendor certificates, for example.
So you can factory reset the device. You can re-register with the vendor who that device belongs now. It is possible to restart the process. You can sort of sell your rights to the device.
Working at the university, I've experienced students registering devices, and then they have already registered, and then we have trouble re-registering them.
Not every approach will work everywhere, right?
And with the MUD concept, essentially, it's not configuring the device, so you don't have to worry. It's not an issue in that context.
Yeah, so Chana Lang, Michael Richardson, well, possibly around the same thing. The need to be able to resell devices is closely associated with the need for owners to have their devices outlive manufacturers, but there are potential replay concerns if we permit resell.
So I think there's a difference between sort of how we would like to have things working and how the current market works. So there's a business question here. If I regularly see manufacturers or vendors going bankrupt and the devices don't work anymore. That has a variety of different reasons. Some of them at the end, when the company goes bankrupt, they release all their code as open source and you can deploy the service on your own. But I fear that many of the incentives for vendors to actually release everything so you can quickly tie them up to other providers is probably not super common in the near future. Just look at the stuff that you're using yourself if you use any of the IoT devices. How many of them you can tie up with random servers?
Carsten Bormann, two things. One, the core working group is probably interested in providing some of the bits and pieces here. So for instance, tomorrow we will talk about Yang on small devices. You can't be there because you're all at Crypto Forum, but we will be talking about it. Sorry for the conflict. But there may be other bits and pieces that we may be able to supply. For something completely unrelated, who in this room cares about remote attestation? Okay, for the three of you. remote attestation is usually done using protocols that have a challenge response mechanism because you want freshness of that attestation. And there are, however, some situations in which device that is verifying and the device that is that needs to provide the attestation do not have bidirectional communication, or it's difficult to have bidirectional communication. And there is a draft out there now in its second revision that provides a time-based version of that remote attestation. So if you're interested in this concept, it's draft Birkholz TUDA, time-based unidirectional attestation 01, and you can talk to Hank Birkholz, Wave Hank, or me about that.
Okay, so do you can send a pointer to the SAG list, maybe would be useful. Send an email to SAG. I guess on your topic, Elliot, if you could send a summary of what you think, what bits and pieces of IETF work would be done, or useful to the SAG list also, that'd be good. We don't have anybody else on mics. I have one question. Does anybody go to ITUT SG17? Bummer, no. We're looking for somebody to we're looking at you. Yes, okay. Please talk to me after. Oh, okay, I see it. Okay, other than that, if nobody else has another topic, we're done. Thank you. See you in Berlin. Thank you. Didn't get to press the red button. Yeah, there's some useful stuff in this space. I wish it didn't all require such manufacturer involvement, but it does kind of. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, no, I mean, I think it's a very valid thing, but I just wish there was another model that didn't have that. I know you're involved in SV7.
You are.
Phil.
Should have said something else.
Oh, sorry, yeah. I saw some mail about it, but I haven't read it, no.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me that...
It's reinventing TLS.
Well, it might... It was to have a backup.